morning and welcome on this 24th day of May to the traditional online worship service of Moody Methodist Church in Galveston, Texas. We're glad you're with us today. We pray today will be a blessing for you as we worship together. A couple of items just want to mention to those of you who live locally. We are going to have a drive-through communion on June 14th. That will be my last Sunday as senior pastor of this great church. I'll be retiring after that date, but we, from 10 a.m. to noon, we'll be serving communion at the porticochet on the side of the church, south side of the church. You'll come in on the U side and exit to the 53rd Street side. So encourage you to do that. One other item I would love for you to be watching for. We're going to be sending out a survey to all the members of our congregation and inviting you to fill out that survey and send it back. It has to do with our reopening and what it will look like around here for our reopening, and we need your input to make that happen. So some will be online, some of it will be in paper form. If you need the paper form, let us know, and you can call the church office and we'll get that down and send it to you. But we need them back in a very timely manner because we're hoping to open again sometime in the near future. Don't know what that date is, but we're hoping that by July 5th we'll be open worshiping and seeing each other again. So we'll see how that works. Anyway, we hope you will enjoy this worship service on this Ascension Sunday. Would you join me in our call to worship? You'll find the words on the screen. Sing praises to God. Sing praises.
Sing praises to our ruler. Sing praises.
For God reigns over the nations.
Sing praises with a song. Alleluia.
Ever living God, your eternal Christ once dwelt on earth, confined by time and space. Give us faith to discern in every time and place the presence among us of him who is head over all things and fills all, ever Jesus Christ, our ascended Lord. Amen. Amen. Our opening hymn is Crown Him with Many Crowns.
Would you join me in the Apostles' Creed? The words are on the screen. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Thank you. Would you pray with me as we lift up our children this day? Let's pray. Lord, we remember how you blessed the disciples before you ascended into heaven. We thank you today for your blessings on our children. We ask for your peace to cover them. We ask for laughter and joy to fill their day. We pray that you would give them boldness and courage to face the challenges set before them with the confidence and calmness that can only come from your Holy Spirit. Bless them and keep them safe. Amen. Let us pray. Lord God, on this Ascension Sunday, may we be mindful that your presence will never leave us or forsake us, even if we don't have you in our physical sight. We give you thanks that you have opened the scriptures to us this Easter season, that the Messiah must suffer, die, and rise from the dead. We give you thanks for the great 50 days of Easter and the beauty of your glorious resurrection. However, this day we're also mindful that our world is not always what it should be. We confess that sometimes we're like the disciples, sometimes afraid, sometimes full of doubt. But in your extravagant generosity, your boundless love, you appear to us in our fear and love us in our doubts and grant us the oceans of your peace. Thank you for loving us as we are and for promising us that there is more to come. May this church be for the world the broken body and blood of your Son, so that our confidence will not be in worldly things. Our confidence instead may be in you, in our baptism, in the church, and in the Spirit who gave life to the church at the beginning. Ascending Christ, you promised to send your Holy Spirit to your holy church. As you have ascended, may your Spirit descend fresh upon us. As you have called us to follow you, may we be bold enough to go into the world in the strength of your Spirit to give ourselves for others. May we follow you into the new creation, for your ascension is our glory and our hope. Loving God, we pray this day for all that are going through sickness, surgeries, hard rehabilitations, for those that are grieving, for those that are displaced. But Lord, help each of us here today to have the words to tell others of your great love for them. All this we ask in your precious name as we say the prayer you taught your disciples, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Our hymn of preparation is, O Christ, when you ascended, 3087 in the new. Thank you.
Our scripture reading this morning comes from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 24, verses 44 and following. Hear these words. Then he said to them, "These are my words that I spoke to you while I was still with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms must be fulfilled." Then he opened their minds to understand the scriptures, and he said to them, "Thus it is written that the Messiah is to suffer and to rise from the dead on the third day, and that repentance and forgiveness of sins is to be proclaimed in his name to all nations, beginning from Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things, and see, I am sending upon you what my Father promised. So stay here in the city until you have been clothed with power from on high." Then he led them out as far as Bethany, and lifting up his hands, he blessed them. While he was blessing them, he withdrew from them and was carried up into heaven. And they worshiped him and returned to Jerusalem with great joy. And they were continually in the temple blessing God. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
The Bible reading you just heard is about Jesus' final curtain before his disciples and before his ascension. The disciples were hanging on every word. This was the last time that he'd ever speak to them in the flesh, and they didn't want to miss a word of it. And so Luke records in his 24th chapter, "Then he opened their minds so that they could understand the scriptures. He told them, this is what is written. The Christ will suffer and rise from the dead on the third day, and repentance and forgiveness of sins will be preached in his name to all nations, beginning in Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things. I'm going to send you what my Father has promised, but stay in the city until you have been clothed with power from on high." When he led them out to the vicinity of Bethany, he lifted up his hands and he blessed them. While he was blessing them, he left them and was taken up into heaven. Then they worshiped him, then they returned to Jerusalem with great joy, and they stayed continually at the temple praising God. What a startling spectacle this must have been. While he was blessing them, he left and was taken up into heaven. How did the disciples feel at that moment? Have you ever asked yourself? Was their sense of loss balanced by a sense of awe? What did it mean when they were told to wait for power from on high? I'm sure they were asking themselves that very question. Newspaper columnist and author Ellen Goodman once wrote about making an exit. She wrote these words, "There's a trick to the graceful exit. It begins with the vision to recognize when a job, a life stage, or a relationship is over and let go. It means leaving what's over without delaying its validity or denying its validity or its past importance in our lives. It involves a sense of future, a belief that every exit line is an entry, that we are moving on rather than out." Miss Goodman's words are awesome when they're applied to the ascension. Jesus' departure wasn't the end of the story. In fact, his ascension into heaven opened the way for the disciples to begin a dynamic, spirit-empowered ministry that spread the good news of salvation all over the world. The end result was the establishment of the Christian church. And what followed out of that was the establishment of hospitals, orphanages, universities, missions. It's like something the poet Tennyson once wrote. He was describing the code of ethics by which ancient knights lived. He said this code had only four components: live pure, speak true, right wrong, follow the king. At its most basic level, this was also the charge that was given to the disciples. Following Jesus' example, they would live holy lives, speak the truth of God's word, right the wrongs of an unjust society, and do all the things their king had done when he walked among them. They were chosen to carry Jesus' work to the whole world. And he had promised them that with his spirit enabling them, they would do even greater things than he had done. So now it's time for a decision. The disciples didn't know the form of power the Holy Spirit would bestow upon them, and they didn't know what sort of risks they were about to face. These were 12 men who had likely never traveled more than 30 or 40 miles from their home village. So how could they preach repentance and forgiveness to all the nations on the face of the earth? After the roller coaster ride of experiences the disciples had just been on, were they ready for this new challenge? Are we ready for this challenge as Christ followers today? Psychologist Martha Beck reports that many of her clients miss great opportunities for happiness because they're afraid of challenge, of failure, of change. They often concoct lame excuses to explain their lack of initiative. In an article in O Magazine, she recounts snippets of actual conversations she's had with unfulfilled clients. I thought you'd enjoy hearing some of these. You might even relate to some of them. Beck: you've been invited to raft the Grand Canyon this summer? That's great. It's exactly what you've always wanted to do. Client: yeah, but I can't go. I have to get my teeth cleaned that week. Here's another Beck: if you really love this man, marry him. Client: yeah, but what if he dies before I do? Beck: you say you'd do anything to work in the automobile industry and you have the credentials, you could start applying for jobs now. Client: yeah, but I'm too tall. Do you hear a continuing theme? Yeah, but. Contrast the yeah, but attitude of Martha Beck's clients with the attitude of comedian Tina Fey, who was a cast member back in 2003 of Saturday Night Live. She credits her current success to the rules she learned in an improvisational acting class. Are you familiar with improv? You are if you've ever watched the TV show Whose Line Is It Anyway? Performers make up scenes, sketches, and songs on the spot. Improv is a risky, exciting art form, and it requires a whole lot of courage to do it right. Faye's teacher, Martin DeMatt, gave the class a list of rules about taking risks. Among the rules were statements like these: greet everything with yes and. Notice that? Not yeah, but yes and. Here's another rule: say yes and you'll figure it out later. And the fun is always on the other side of yes. Tina Fey memorized each one of these rules. They came in handy when she was faced with new opportunities and challenges. Rather than giving in to fear or self-doubt, she would automatically focus on these rules. Because she used the yes rules as a guideline, she took on new challenges and she found success far beyond any of her expectations. So the question this morning is, what is your response to God's calling on your life? Yeah, but, or yes, and? What if you automatically followed the yes rules in your relationship with God? How would it change your life? Do you trust God with your life without reservation? According to Pastor Randy Frazee, leaders can attract either fans or followers. Fans like the leader. They're attracted by the leader's personality or charisma. Followers, on the other hand, are attracted by the leader's vision. Followers want to be challenged by great goals. They want to commit to something larger than themselves. Among the crowds who came to see Jesus preach and teach, many were fans, but only a few were true followers. The disciples were not just fans. They were true followers. They were yes and men. They waited for the power from on high, and when they received it, they went out and preached and taught and healed and performed miracles far beyond their own abilities. And today, Jesus' message is still proclaimed. His name is still worshiped. His power is still available to people of every nation on the face of this earth. You and I have salvation and new life because one day, 2,000 years ago, a small band of men and women said yes and to Jesus' calling. But their work isn't finished. Christ is still looking for men and women who will say yes and. Will Willimon was the Hearn Lecture Series speaker for us a couple of years ago, bishop, retired bishop in the United Methodist Church, but before that, he was dean of the chapel at Duke University. And he received a phone call one day from a very irate father. The caller told Will furiously, "I hold you personally responsible for this." He was angry because his graduate school-bound daughter had decided to, in his words, throw it all away and go do mission work in Haiti with the Presbyterian Church. The father screamed, "Isn't that absurd? She has a BS degree from Duke and she's going off to dig ditches in Haiti? I hold you responsible for this." Willimon said, "Well, why me?" The father said, "You ingratiated yourself and you filled her mind with all this religious stuff." Willimon was not easily intimidated. He asked the father, "Sir, weren't you the one who had her baptized?" "Well, yes," said the father. "And didn't you take her to Sunday school when she was a little girl?" Well, yes," said the father. And didn't you allow your daughter to go on those youth group ski trips to Colorado when she was in high school?" "Yeah, what does that have to do with anything?" "Sir," said Willimon, "you're the reason she's throwing it all away. You introduced her to Jesus, not me." "But," said the father, "all we wanted was for her to be a Presbyterian." Willimon responded, "Well, sorry, sir, but you messed up. You've gone and made a disciple." The father was a yeah, but follower. And he didn't quite know what to do when his daughter said yes, and. How about you? What's your response to God today? I pray that like those early disciples, your response is yes and. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, amen. Our closing hymn this morning is "I'll Fly Away." Words will be on the screen.
I'll fly away.
And now may the grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, the love of God, the communion and fellowship of his Holy Spirit abide with each and every one of us, now and forevermore. Amen.